So we're going to move on to a new topic, but before we do that, I want to expand on the little example that we've just seen where we used what is actually a dihedral group. So I want to get to a new topic, but first let's stick to these dihedral groups. Remember the example that I used in the previous video, just the four elements, and we transform that. So when we get to this dihedral group, we usually donate a D, and we have a little subscript N, and that N is an element of the natural numbers. So what's going on here? This is where we have this interesting idea where we take something that we can actually look at and we transform it by flipping it, or we rotate it, and what we want that object is to look exactly the same as we did before. So we had, remember, so we had our little square and we had numbers to 1, 2, 3, 4, but what we want to do to that is to rotate it or flip it, you know, along any of the diagonals, so that if I didn't put numbers to that, it was just that little square. If you looked at it and you looked away and I changed it and you look back again, you notice no difference. That square looks exactly the same. Now we've marked them 1, 2, 3, 4, so we can see that had moved, but when you just look at that square without the numbers there, you don't see anything, nothing has changed. And that's what we talk about, the dihedral group. And they're very interesting when n equals 1, when n equals 2, but when it gets to 3, 4 and more, then it gets more interesting. And what we are dealing with here is just as we're dealing with permutations. So we're going to do the permutations on the number of elements, and we're only going to take, and every permutation we're going to give a symbol to. Remember, we say sigma and we say tau. So every permutation we give a symbol to, and some of those symbols are going to make it into a group. So when we had those symmetric groups, all the permutations make it into a group. When we have a cyclic group, it's only the cyclic permutations that make it into a group. With the dihedral groups, it's slightly different, and I want to show you how we do this. Now let's just start with D1. So if we want to imagine something, let's not stick to a square, because a square has four sides. Let's just stick to something that's a bit easier to see and note, and that's just a circle, and we have one there. There's just one element, and if we, you know, if we permute one, it's just one goes to one. One goes to one. There is just the identity element. And the way that I can do that through symmetry is, if you look at this, what I could do is I could rotate it through 2 pi radians, full 360 degrees, and it will look exactly the same. Or if I were to, technically, if I were just to flip it like this, it would stay the same. But one is just mapped to one, that's all I have. And that's not very interesting. So let's look at D2. So again with this, and I have one there and I have two there. So what I could do, if you looked away, is consider this line of symmetry here, and I could just flip it this way around. And if the numbers 1 and 2 weren't there, you wouldn't notice that there was any difference. And what would happen to the 1, it would stay by 1 and 2 would stay by 2. So 1 would go to 1 and 2 would go to 2, and that would just be an identity element. But I could do something else. I could rotate it through pi radians, 180 degrees. If I were to do that, then I would have one to one and two to two. So one would go to two and two would go to one. And we'll just call that tau 1, 2. One goes to two and two goes to one. In a cycle, we would just write it like that. This cycle here would just be one. So here we would have two elements. We would still have the identity element. And that is where we just do this flipping here, this transformation. But I could also just rotate it through. I could rotate it through pi radians, 180 degrees, and I get this. Let's just keep it tau, because there is just this one. So there are these two elements. And it is a group. You can go through. There is closure, there is associativity, there is an identity element, and each one of these are their own inverses. If I, you know, tau and compose with another tau, it's just going to give me the identity element. Identity element composed with the identity element is going to give me the identity element. When we get to D3, things become a bit more interesting. So let's just have our 1, 2, 3. So the what we can do here, I mean, we are going to have the 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and that is just the identity element. We can rotate it through, so we take 360 degrees and we divide it by 3. That's one, suddenly I can't think, 120 degrees. We rotate by 120 degrees, so 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 1. So we'll have this 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes back to 1. And what we'll call that is we'll call that sigma. If I go the other way around, or I do this twice, I'm going to give 1 to 3, 3 to 2, and 2 to 1. So 1 is going to go to 3, 3 is going to 2, and 2 goes back to 1, and we call that one sigma squared, remember? Now I have this line of symmetry here, and if I flip this way around, 1 stays with 1, and 2 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 2, so that's another cycle. If I did this line of symmetry here, 3 stays where it was, and 1 or 2 would flip. So 1 goes to 2, and 2 goes to 1, that's that. If I did this line of symmetry here, we'd note that 1 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 1, so that was the cycle 1, 3. And that was nothing other than what we had. Let me write this out very neatly here. So the dihedral group with three elements, remember that would be the identity element. We had tau, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1. We had tau, 1 goes to 3, and 3 goes to 1. And we had tau 2, 3. And then we had sigma, and we had sigma squared. So certainly something we've seen before, and we can make this into a group by group composition there. And we've seen before that if we were to do this, so this is actually just a triangle, what I can do with this equilateral triangle. And if I have 1, 2, and 3, and I would to rotate them, or I would use these lines of symmetry here. If I were to have these lines of symmetry, and I would reflect them there, you know, this is exactly, and you looked away, you wouldn't notice nothing has changed about that triangle. And we've seen this one, this example very neatly, and now we can just call it what it is. It's a dihedral group in three elements. And then we got the example where we looked at the dihedral group in four elements, the dihedral group in four elements, and this is what we had here. And we saw all the rotations and reflections that we could do to do that. The next one I want to jump to is not D5, but D6. And the way that I'm going to show you D6 is just using a computer program. And so I'm going to record my screen and talk you through what happens to D6. Because when it comes to D6 is probably, for me, the first interesting one, because D4 is a bit small. Because what we are after in the end here is the center of a group. And if we look, if we look at D6, for instance, we could work out what the center of a group is. And in the next video, we'll start looking at that and see if we can find the center of the dihedral group in six elements. Here I am in my web browser, and I've typed in the URL www.wolframcloud, that's wolframcloud.com. And if you go to Programming Lab, if you hit that, you can open a free account, and you can code in the Wolfram language right inside of your browser. So you can go ahead and do that. You can also, of course, use a desktop copy of Mathematica, which you can either purchase, or if you're at an institution, a university, or your work, where you might have a site license to use to get a copy for free. But otherwise, go to Programming Lab, then open a free account, and you can code right inside of a browser. It's wonderful to do. So let's have a look. Let's have a look at just these dihedral groups. So this is what is called a notebook. You would see almost exactly the same thing if we were to do this in a browser. And I can just type normal words and sentences there, etc. And I've made a little title there. So what I'm after is the group elements. So I'm going to say group elements. And I'm going to pass an argument to it. And arguments all go inside of what is called the square brackets. And I'm going to say the dihedral group, I see it coming up there, I can just hit tab to autocomplete. And I want 1 and 4 elements. So open and close with square brackets the 4, that is an argument passed to the dihedral function, and then close the square bracket again for the group elements. Simple as that. And shift and enter, and we see all the cycles. And we note that there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 cycles. and you'll see there is a pattern to it, the number of elements. These are now all going to be elements inside of this dihedral group, and it will have 2n, here n is 4, so it's going to have 8. It's going to have 8 elements, and we were going to name all of these. Now, the way that Mathematica works, or the Wolfram language, cycles with nothing in it, that just refers to the identity element. So 1's going to go to 1, 2 to 2, 3 to 3, 4 to 4. And we see another cycle there, and that is where 2 goes to 4, 1 stays with as 1, and 3 stays with 3. And we see another cycle, 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 1, and 3 goes to 4, and 4 goes to 3. We see a cycle where 1 goes to 2, 2 goes to 3, 3 goes to 4, and we see a cycle, and what we would do is just to name these, and we'll have an identity element, and we'll have some sigmas, and we'll have some taus, etc. And that is a very easy way, if it starts getting big, to just write a single line of code like this and to get these answers. Now, the next thing I want to do is just to show you the Cayley table of this. So let's have table form. So I'm going to say table form, and I want the dihedral group. The dihedral group in 4 elements, and I'm just going to use what is called postfix notation. Don't worry about that. This is not to teach you how to code. So I want the group multiplication table, and I want some table headings, and we're going to make the table headings just automatic. So what that is going to do for us is the following. And there we go, we see the 8 elements. Now it's going to number them 1 through to 8, 1 through to 8, instead of using sigma, and because you can actually use, you can use any symbols you want. I mean, there are some symbols that are used commonly in textbooks and by your lecturers, but what the Wolfram language and Mathematica here is going to do is just going to name them 1 through 8, the 8, or these 3 8 elements that we have in our group, and we see the composition. So we see the composition in this order that we see them here. 1 composed with 1 is going to give you 1, 3 composed with 3 is going to give you back the 1, and you've got to go look what the third cycle was, and you know, whatever you named it. So that is, you know, that is such a beautiful thing to do. So let's look at this group element. Let's look at this the group elements of the dihedral group. The dihedral group with 6. So remember, there's got to be 12 elements in this, and we see all the cycles there. And I'm just going to copy and paste. So copy and paste there, and let's just change this to 6. So let's just look at the group composition table there, and we see the 12 elements in the group composition. And it is from this that we're going to try and look at finding, if at all possible, the center. We're going to try and find the center of this dihedral group in 6, with 6 elements. So there you go, that is the dihedral group. It's actually very nice, a fantastic sort of thing to start playing with. Perhaps have a look at some Wolfram language code and see if you can play around and create some of these on your own.